I'm meteorologist Jason Parkin. Of course, we've been through what's been a warm winter in the upper Midwest. We're now into March, and our attention turns toward the growing season and the warm season, which is, it seems like, has been upon us maybe earlier this year than it normally is. I wanted to bring in a friend of mine named Mike Tannura. Mike is a meteorologist, and he and I went to Iowa State together a while back. Mike is the founder, owner, and president of T-Storm Weather, and Mike does forecasting for folks who trade commodities, beans and corn and oats. And Mike, am I getting that right so far?
Yeah, the only one you missed is wheat.
Wheat, okay, well, that's an important one, and we don't maybe think about it as much in Iowa. Mike, you and I went to Iowa State so long ago that it's when Twister came out. And now, of course, there's Twisters. That's how old we are. There's a whole new movie. So just to give folks a perspective of how close to death both of us are. But in any event, I saw you give a brief little snippet of your forecast for the upcoming spring and summer a while back. And I wanted to share that with our viewers because I know there's a lot of folks out there interested in weather. A lot of them, of course, have businesses that are related to agriculture, but some of them are just gardeners and people who ride bikes and things like that. And so if you would kind of walk us through what you've seen and what you think might happen as we head into the warmer months of the year.
Yeah, well, that sounds great. You know, thanks for having me as well. You know, it is interesting because a lot of the times when you're making long-range weather forecasts, it's very difficult to do because there's just too many data points and you can come up with a number of different conclusions. But in the situation that we're in right now, there's a number of indications that we can see at least a couple of things that are pretty probable to happen. So Jason, what I'm gonna do here is we'll take a look at the presentation that I put together, which should give you a pretty good idea of how it's all going to work out. So temperatures have been unusually mild over the last several months. This is a look at those temperature departures over the last 90 days. And you can see that from northern Iowa on to the north, it was unusually warm. In fact, it's off of our scale here for the last 90 days, which means it was more than 8 degrees warmer per normal on average over each day in a 90-day period. I mean, that's pretty incredible as of in of itself. Now, if you start to look here at some of the pieces of this, and you can start to look back in time. What we're doing here is we're taking out the 7-state Corn Belt, which is basically the states surrounding Iowa and then a little bit over to the east into Ohio. And when you average out their temperatures over the course of December into January through February, which basically represents the winter, this is a look at those temperatures going back more than 130 years. And a couple of things you'll notice is that number one, we just went through the mildest winter on record. So it was historic by all measures across the 7-state Corn Belt. The other thing you might notice is that temperatures have been steadily increasing over this period of time, and a pretty marked change has occurred because you go back to the very first winter of our record in 1895 into 96. Well, that was almost 4 degrees colder per day on average than now. And that just means that these winters are so much milder now than they were back then. Now, that's all related to climate change and all that stuff that we're not going to get into. But the thing I do want you to note is this. The reason it's been so unusually mild this winter is not necessarily because of global warming or anything related to that. It's due to the El Nino. If you look here at these red dots, these are the most similar El Ninos to the one that we just went through. And when we're talking about El Nino, we're looking at a phenomenon out in the Pacific Ocean. But pretty much, if you know you have a moderate to strong El Nino that's coming up, you almost know that it's going to be really mild across the central U.S. And that's what these data points here are showing. Now, keep in mind, Jason, at the beginning of this winter, we didn't really know for sure what this winter was going to be like. But all indications right. were that it probably would end up being much warmer than normal, simply because three of the last four that had a similar setup ended up like that. And now you can see that it's 4 of 5.
Right. And so, Mike, when you talk about El Nino, just briefly, you're talking about a warming of the waters in the eastern Pacific, right, basically?
Well, essentially, it's this map here. This is a look at the northern hemisphere and the southern hemisphere. So basically, you know, a big chunk of the world. And when that water out there in the middle of the Pacific Ocean is warmer than normal, we call it an El Nino. And it's no more complicated than that. So that water is warmer than normal. We're in an El Nino setup. And that water was way warmer than normal over the course of the winter. And that's why we say it was moderate to strong. Now, when it's in a La Nina phase, that means it's colder than normal. But for what we're concerned about, we just were in this very strong El Nino, and we're still in it. But the thing to keep in mind is just what's going to happen going forward. This is where it gets a little bit interesting. So this is a look at those water temperatures in that very area that I just showed you. So the most similar ones to that one were these winters here, 72 into 73, 82 into 83, and you can see the other years. So again, that's how we came up with that conclusion, that we looked at those winters and we said, hey, three of those four were way warmer than normal, so this one probably would be too.
So this is called
El Nino is ending.
An analog here, right?
So what we're looking at is what's going to happen next.
Okay. Right. Okay.
And Jason, check out this chart here. This kind of gets into the meat of what's coming up for the growing season for the central U.S. summer. So we're in this moderate to strong El Nino. It's now starting to fall apart. And you can see that it falls apart rapidly a lot of the times. We basically have five other years that were similar to the one that's coming up. And this data goes back about 65 years or so. So five of those had a similar transition to the one that's coming up. And this is essentially what we're going to look at for projections for the future for the Corn Belt. And, you know, a lot of people are thinking about planting corn and soybeans coming up next month and in May and even into June in parts of the Corn Belt. And if you look here at rainfall across the seven-state Corn Belt, almost all of those were wetter than normal, and some of them were quite a bit wetter than normal. So right off the bat, we have to start thinking about that. And Jason, you know, one thing that people like to talk about when they're talking about corn and soybeans is the planting season, which is this year. But what really matters is what comes up in the summer, because, I mean, in almost all examples, the crops will get planted. It's just a matter of exactly what day it is. And generally, the earlier the better, because you run less risk of running into summer heat or summer dryness once things start to dry out from a climatological standpoint in the summer. Well, we find it pretty unlikely that the next few months would end up being drier than normal. You know, historically, when you have this type of El Nino that's fading away in the manner that it's expected to, you almost always end up near or wetter than normal. So, you know, the chances are that this growing season will start out on a good note with some decent rainfall. The only concern there might be if you get too much rain, but at least at this point in time, you know, even look out the window today, this is kind of an example of what may be coming up for the future. But where things start to fall apart a little bit is once you get into the heart of the growing season. You look at July and August. This is what really drives these crops. If you look at it from that standpoint, there's not a real strong connection here between this El Nino and what's going to happen later in the summer. Probably the most obvious examples are 1983 and 2016. 1983 was the fourth driest July-August period on record in our dating going back to 1960. But 2016 was number two wettest. So you pretty much have the full range of potential as far as rainfall goes. But this is the one that really sticks out to us as being the most important. If you look at temperatures in the month of August, every single one of them was at least moderately warmer than normal across the seven-state Corn Belt when you have this type of transition. And so that pretty much means that heat is going to be showing up at some point in the summer, most likely after the middle of July. For corn, that's always a problem because they're sensitive to rainfall or temperatures at that time of the year, with heat being bad and cool weather being good. So this is more than likely going to limit the potential of U.S. corn production. Same story for soybeans, except that they're a little bit less sensitive to temperature, and the rain piece of it is going to come into play. But the rain piece is the one that's uncertain. You can't really say how that one's going to work out. But, you know, it would historically be anomalous to end up having a cool summer with this type of transition.
Is there anything you are concerned about going into this growing season, at least in the upper Midwest? And obviously we're in central Iowa, but, you know, in general.
Well, I think heat has to be the thing you have to keep an eye out for. You know, once we get into July, that's where corn and soybean yields are really being, you know, they're starting to be tuned at that point in time. So the weather right then is super important. If you have a nice cool summer, even if you don't have a lot of rain, you can have a pretty nice crop. But even if you get a lot of rain, if you have some big heat, like we did in 1983 or 1995, which again are analogs to this setup, that's where you start to run into the risk of problems. this would be the kind of setup where you have high temperatures in the mid to upper 90s and lows in the mid 70s to low 80s. So, you know, that is the big risk here, that once we get into the heart of the summer, that we start to see some big heat show up. It doesn't happen every single time we have this setup, but it did happen twice. And even in the other 4 years where it wasn't super hot, it was still warmer than normal. So, Jason, I just would emphasize that, you know, more than likely we're going to end up having a hot summer. Whether or not it's dry to go along with that, you know, that one we don't have a lot of confidence in. And ultimately, rain is the most important thing to these crops. So, you know, still uncertain there, but all in all, I'd just be looking for late summer heat.
All right, so Mike, in these analog years we looked at, the years that are most similar to the winter we've been through and what we're going into, how did those years turn out in terms of yield and agriculture in the Corn Belt?
Well, it wasn't always a bad story. U.S. corn yields actually turned out to be okay 4 out of those 6 times. So, you know, just because we're going through this transition and is likely to be hot later on in the summer, it's not necessarily the time to start panicking. The only real observations we had of very poor yields were in 1983 due to a prolonged heat wave and drought, and in 1995 due to a severe heat wave over the later part of the summer. So that's kind of the corn story. You know, 4 or 6 were okay, 2 were poor. This is an elevated risk compared to a normal season, but it's not time to fire off the alarm bells yet. For soybeans, the story is a little bit better than for corn, and that's primarily because, again, they're not as dependent on heat. They're more driven by rainfall. So if it gets real hot, soybeans can generally get through that a little bit better than corn. And that's why 5 of the 6 years had normal crops or better than normal crops. Only 1983 was that really poor one. So in the end, Jason, while we do have some legitimate weather risks coming up, whether or not it turns into big risks to the actual final crop size, that'll have to be determined depending on how all these pieces work out.
Thanks for all that, Mike. Very interesting stuff. Obviously, in the weather office, we deal a lot with the next, let's say, 7 to 10 days, and it's nice to have an expert come on to tell us about the growing season and long-term concerns, for especially for folks in agriculture. But if you would, just give folks a nickel tour of what you do in case they're interested in your services.
Yeah, no, that sounds fantastic, and thanks again for having me. You know, T-Storm Weather is a website that essentially forecast weather for corn, soybean, and wheat traders. And we do have some producers in that mix as well. But these are all people that are either trading or hedging in the futures market. And we essentially talk about things like this, both in a daily newsletter and then in a monthly newsletter that talks about El Nino and long-range forecasting and things along those lines. But for the most part, we're focused 1 to 2 weeks out. You know, everybody kind of knows the forecast to some extent 3 to 5 days out, at least as far as futures trading goes. Although there's always that unusual setup where things get a little crazy and you don't know. But in general, you know, we're just focused a little bit further out. And as the computer models keep getting better and better at forecasting the near term, as far as futures traders go, you just keep pushing that forecast horizon further into the future. So, you know, if you start getting great forecasts in 5 days from now, we'll just start forecasting 10 days out is what's going to happen. So that's kind of the, you know, how to sum it all up. We also do some yield forecasting for corn and soybeans in the United States, as well as in Argentina and Brazil, and even Paraguay. So we're kind of a full service to kind of keep an eye on, especially corn and soybean farmers, and then with wheat added on as well, including U.S. spring wheat, which has been one of our newer products forecasting those yields as well. TStorm.net is the website. And Jason, you know it, just like I know about you. You know, I'm passionate about the weather. You are too. And, you know, this is just a real nice way to kind of be able to present this to people in a way that helps them to make decisions.
Yeah, I hear you, buddy. Well, Mike Tannura, founder, owner, president, T-Storm Weather, meteorologist, friend, thank you very much for your time today.
Hey, thanks a lot. Anytime.